Okay, good morning and welcome everyone to the fifth meeting of the Local Government Communities Committee. I can remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones, and as meeting papers are provided in digital format, tablets may be used by members during the meeting, so that's what we're doing if you see us use those. We've got a full attendance here today and no apologies been received from members. And we move to agenda item one, which is evidence on subordinate legislation. The committee will take evidence in the council tax substitution of proportion Scotland Order 2016 from two panels. And I now welcome our first panel. So can I welcome Professor Kenneth Gibb, Director Policy, Scotland University of Glasgow. Good morning, Professor Gibb. Professor David Bell, Professor of Economics, University of Stirling. Good morning, Professor Bell. And Professor Richard Kerley, Professor of Management, Queen Margaret University. And good morning to you as well, Professor Kerley. As indicated before the meeting, there's an opportunity for all three of you, if you wish to make opening statements. Given we're a bit truncated for time, of an hour and 15 minutes or so, it would be good if those were relatively brief, and then we'll move to questions. So would anyone like to make an opening statement? Professor Gibb.
Thank you very much. I just want to reiterate some of the points I made in my written evidence. First of all, that while we're here to talk about the statutory instrument, I think we would probably, all three of us, want to look at this in the broader picture and some of the other things that are happening actually or potentially with local taxation in Scotland. Plus some reflections. I think it's clear that the proposed re-weightings of the higher bands will make the council tax less regressive, but it's still far from a proportionate or neutral system. Perhaps one of the most important things is that there is no proposal for a general revaluation. I'm sure we'll talk about that quite a lot. And one of my concerns is that we may find ourselves, or some of us, back here in 4 or 5 years discussing this again because we haven't grasped that issue of how to set the tax base. I also thought that the proposal to compensate lower income households who are going to pay more council tax as a result of the re-weighting, that we should take account of the fact that this is a means-tested system, that there are questions about the take-up of that, particularly for the group of people who will be directly affected by it, and I think we should bear that in mind. And I think most of my other points, I'm sure, will come up in discussion. I just wanted to make those points to start with.
Professor Gibb, Professor Bell.
Okay, I'll be brief. I think this is, I agree with Professor Gibb that we probably will want to look at the broader implications of this statutory instrument. I think it's, for example, a limited reform given the aspirations of the local tax committee last year. I think the way that the new ratios will work will inevitably mean some redistribution across local authorities, and I think it's important to take a broader understanding of what these mean. I agree with Professor Gibb about potential implications of the new addition to the council tax reduction scheme, in that it is quite complex, and I worry a bit about the correct population of potential recipients of this additional reduction being properly identified. And then I'm a little concerned about the where we are in terms of redirecting the monies raised from this increase in the ratios solely to schools. It's as if it's a hypothecated tax. And I also think, picking up on Professor Gibb's point, that we probably want to understand, I think, a bit more clearly the distinction between taxing wealth and taxing income, and how those two might be considered together when we're thinking about the progressivity or regressivity of a tax.
Thank you. Professor Kerley?
Yes, Convener, I'll try and be equally as colleagues have been. There are two or three issues that I think the committee should turn its attention to. The first and this does bear on fairness because it relates to the value on which, described value on which a tax level will be struck, which is the evasion of revaluation. I think it just simply quite negligent to assume that we should stick with 1991 valuations. The fairness or unfairness that arises from that is quite simple, that if you paid tax, i.e. income tax in this year on your current income, and I were allowed to pay income tax on my 1991 income, you would think that was a fairly rough deal for you. I, of course, would be delighted. But in terms of the principle of fairness, we should be considering the overall valuation level and the fairness that rises from that. I favour a property tax, I favour a form of taxation of property that is mediated in some way by elements of income. And I think the Committee on Local Taxation Reform was signalling that, working towards it, but then it becomes a matter for how government introduces. I also share the view that the council tax reduction scheme seems to me quite problematic. We extend the level of income at which that reduction will operate some way beyond many other means-tested schemes. And we know that when we have means-tested schemes, they are often poor in take-up, though the variation in take-up across different benefits is not still fully established. But I suspect that the confident projection of, I think it's £7 million as being the cost of that, may be impacted by the proportion of households that take that up. That again turns upon fairness. I remain in favour of discrete valuation by property. I think the system of property banding also introduces an element of unfairness in that people who are just over the floor of a particular band are paying significantly more than those who are just under the ceiling of the band immediately below them. We have moved on a long way in terms of how we can value properties at any one point. 1991, we didn't have the technologies available to us that the assessors and the valuers have at the moment. The final point is about the extent to which this will impact on local authorities in terms of how they might implement a scheme. I ask in my very short statement of evidence exactly what scheme are they implementing. At one point, we were presented with a proposition that the additional revenues generated by the change multipliers would be put into some schools in Scotland, I think initially on a mechanism based on particular local authorities. The signalling or the discussion that is now current implies a transfer of education funds directly to schools across the piece. I can only assume that the way in which the government intends to operate that is to reduce central grant and assume that local authorities will generate additional revenues through changes in both the multiplier and the probable increase in council tax that we'll see next year. And I think that leaves a pretty big gap, considering we're now only a few months away from introducing these arrangements. I think it is unsatisfactory that we don't yet have a clear indication of how that transfer of monies will take place. In principle, of course, as has been suggested, I object to that transfer. I think a local taxation should be allocated to local decisions rather than appropriated by central government.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen. Before I move to the first question, all three of you are right to mention there's an opportunity to raise wider issues rather than just the statutory instrument before us. But just for the record, the two aspects that we're specifically looking at, as well as those wider issues, are the government's current proposals, reforms making the system of council tax fairer, and to what extent will those changes be straightforward for local authorities to implement. I should also note that whilst we are not reporting in relation to the council tax reduction scheme for the estimated 54,000 families on net incomes of below £25,000, we can take evidence on it, and we'll give that evidence to the Social Security Committee that will be reporting in relation to that matter. So just get that put on the record before we go any further. First question, Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, convener. Just for the record, I was a member of the Commission on Local Tax Reform. I want to ask you a question about progressivity. We cited in the Tax Commission a quote from the Murdley's review that, and I quote, there's a strict economic definition of progressivity. A tax is said to be progressive when the average tax rate rises as the tax base rises. So an income tax is progressive when the average tax rate rises as income rises. In your evidence, Professor Bell, you say that those on higher incomes will contribute a larger share of their income in council tax after the change in ratios is introduced. Hence, the policy can reasonably be described as progressive. Given that there's a charts and data in the Commission's report showing that the council tax overall is regressive with respect to its own tax base and net equivalised household incomes, I'm just wondering whether you can provide any clarity, because these words are being bandied about and they are politically loaded as well, but you're economists and various other kinds of academics, and so I'm sure you have the answer.
But the answer, who'd like to give us the answer first?
Well, so the I guess what I was saying that was in relation to the previous situation, which was admittedly regressive, we've moved a fraction upwards. I think that was solely the point that I was trying to make. I wasn't trying to say that this is now a progressive tax. I was trying to say that In response to the question, is it fairer? I suppose one could say marginally so, but not sort of universally so. I think that's all that I was trying to say.
Okay, Professor Gibb?
Yeah, I mean, I think I would add to that there's obviously a much broader debate and a debate that was held by the Commission regarding whether when we think about progressivity, it's simply about in relation to current income, as important as that obviously is, and as important in terms of the public responses that the Commission had about that focus. I think both Professor Bell and I have said in our written evidence that one also has to think about taxation in terms of wealth and the impacts that it has on wealth and the fairness that has. And I think we were both in different ways making the point that housing taxation as a whole and in terms of wealth is kind of flawed in terms of the impacts it has, and there's arguably very important consequences of that for the productivity of the economy, for making choices to tax income as opposed to property and things of that kind, which kind of in the longer term have really quite significant consequences on an efficiency basis, let alone on the fairness agenda, which is obviously so important.
Professor Kelly, do you want to add anything to that?
Yes, we were asked, or the committee has specifically asked for information on whether this is fairer. And that, to me, is a word that is very, very hard to define. You know, you have a technical definition of progressive. I, in fact, said in my very short note of evidence that I think it is slightly less unfair, which is a kind of guarded way of arguing about it. But I would agree with my colleagues that when we talk about wealth and income, what is striking to me is that when you look across the larger developed economies, say within the OECD, you find considerable variation as between per capita wealth and income. It depends on a whole variety of factors, including how you property tenure, how you ascribe pension benefits and pension savings and things like that. So it's better, but it's still not marvellous.
Do we come back on that, Andy? Billion supplementary.
Thanks very much. Good morning. Thanks for coming to give evidence. Professor Gibb, in your submission to us, you talk about the weighting being more fair, but the values that place the properties in the bands will in most cases be wrong and increasingly illegitimate. And you then go on to talk about it as a political fudge, which does not resolve the underlying problems indicated above. If a revaluation were to take place, would that make it less regressive, more progressive? Would it make a difference to the fairness question that we ask?
That's a very fair question. I think this is about the necessary conditions for an adequate system of property taxation. And I would argue that you know, where we have property tax systems around the world which are deemed to be relatively effective, they all have regular revaluations. Often every year they revalue. It's an automatic part of the process. But in a situation where property values, which we base the location of individual properties into bands, are based on 1991 values, where the evidence to the Commission suggested from a very large sample local authorities that maybe 57% are in the wrong bands, some too low and some too high. That really does undermine the credibility of the system. So it's about the underlying credibility. There's then a second question as to what tax rates you apply and what your fundamental fairness is. But it's a necessary condition. And those of us who generally would support the idea of property taxation recognise that there's a necessary condition that has to be met, and that's what the revaluation issue is about, to me, at least, if that helps.
Professor Bell, Professor Kelly, do you want to add anything to that?
What I would say is that house price inflation affects different localities across the UK, across Scotland, differentially. So a city like Dundee has not seen its property values increase all that much since 1992, whereas Edinburgh obviously has seen big increases. And if you think, well, in a sense, that's an arbitrary increase in people's wealth. You know, they haven't done anything. They just happen to live in the right place. And they will be able to transfer that arbitrary increase in wealth to succeeding generations. And especially if they move away, then they'll be able to realise some of that increase in wealth, which hasn't come out through economic activity. It's just by the dint of the fact that they're living in the right place. So, I think there is a strong case for trying to proportionately tax that arbitrary increase in wealth. And you're only going to be able to do that if you can accurately value the housing stock in the different places. I took 2 minutes the other night on Zoopla. It cost me nothing. I got an immediate valuation for the house I'm living in. They knew what it cost when we bought it. And I just find it difficult to believe that it is such a difficult problem now to revalue Scotland's housing stock.
Professor Kelly, do
you want to tie that? I'd stress a couple of elements, Convener and Ms. Smith. The first is that there is the technical issue that Ken referred to. You know, surely if you are carrying out a census, which is in effect what a property revaluation is, you want that to be as accurate as you can be and to be refreshed regularly rather than being left for, you know, if you actually proposed as a legislature that we should have revaluation of properties on 30-year intervals, people would laugh you out of whatever international bodies legislators are represented in. So that is a significant concern. Would that improve fairness? Yes, it would. It might upset some people who would find their property revalued up. It might please some who saw their property revalued down, but it would indisputably be fairer. There are sub-elements of this which are clearly of concern to many citizens, and I think it's the valuers who refer to it, which is that any revaluation that arises from house improvement is not taken account of until the sale of the property onward. Now, part of what we have seen, at least in the period since about 2007, so we're now talking about nearly 10 years, is a significant investment. You can observe it as you walk around the streets of any town or city in house improvement rather than house movement. I don't have the figures and I don't know if they're available. People are sitting on a wall of potential revaluation change without that coming through into the system.
Thank you, Professor Kelly. Graham Simpson, just before I take you, is odd revaluation.
Yes.
Right, on you go, Graham.
Yeah. So to pick you up on that last point, Professor Curley, you're absolutely right. It's always struck me as ridiculous that you can only ask for your house to be revalued within 6 months of moving into it. So whether it's right or wrong, and a lot of them are at the wrong value, that's your time limit, so you can't challenge it. That seems to me a kind of ludicrous situation. Professor Gibb, you mentioned other countries where they do revaluation every year. I'd be quite interested if you know the names of these countries, what they are and the experiences they've had, and also if any of you know about the experience, I think Wales have done a revaluation, if you can give us any evidence on that.
To remember countries that I don't want to say, which I think are probably annual, but I'm not absolutely positive. I did a report for the Local Tax Commission, which is on their website, which I think has that detail. But there are states within the United States that definitely revalue on that regular basis. I'm not sure, but I think I don't want to say one I'm not absolutely sure about, but there certainly are states that do that. The point is that technically, with automated valuation systems, it's a kind of statistical exercise. It's not a difficult thing to do in the great scheme of things. The work that Chris Leishman did, which I mentioned earlier, which was this sense that taking a sample of 700,000 properties, it was relatively straightforward to use data in Scotland pretty quickly to work out where properties, which band they would now be in if the bands were updated to 2000 to contemporary values. It's really not a technically demanding thing. It's all about the politics of doing it, you know.
Okay, and the Welsh experience, I think, Mr. Simpson was asking about.
Yeah, I think the thing with the Welsh experience is I think there is some evidence that it, I mean, there was an attempt to transition the way people were affected by the revaluation. I think there was some political unpopularity around that, undoubtedly. So I think it was something that was carried out and was ultimately successful because it was achieved, but there was quite a lot of, you know, white noise around it, undoubtedly.
In Wales, have they said that they'll do it on a regular basis from now on?
That I don't know. I couldn't answer that.
Ruth McGuire's on revaluation. Yeah, Ruth.
Thank you, convener. On the point of revaluation, I was interested in the notion of discrete property valuation and just to hear a bit more about the practicalities of that, and also the opinion of the panels as to whether we should build something in that means we don't end up in this position again. So we build something in that means that revaluation is part of things moving forward.
Who'd like to answer that? Professor Kearley.
I'll have a stab at that. Discrete, clearly, as the name implies, says that you attribute a particular value to each property, and the only occasion on which we attribute some form of value to a single property at the moment is at the point of transaction. Now, when I use the phrase some form of value, we know there are market pressures on that. At particular times in the cycle, somebody will say, I think my house is worth £150,000 and nobody will buy that, so I'll sell it for £140,000. A month later, 2 months, 3 months later, it might be worth 155, up or down. And the majority of people would understand that, even if they were slightly galled by it or indeed ragingly angry, as you can see from people who sit on an attempted sale for months and months thinking, my house is worth this and I must get it. But if there is a mass valuation of particular assets in a given street in a particular form, then, you know, that will be for valuers to take a view on whether that is attributable to every single property or not. You know, it's probably slightly easier on very homogenous types of property, but in parts of cities and parts of towns, it's kind of, well, yeah, that one, we don't know how big that is. Well, we can now work out an awful lot of that. As David Bell said, you can look up some of that and get a valuation for your own property, which is at least approximate. What we have at the moment is a band within which your property sits. Now, that provides a measure of safety for decision makers and valuers to say, well, it's around about 180 grand or whatever it might be. And there are analogies, actually there are analogies in university education. Many of us used to mark people as A, B, C, D, E. We no longer get away with that. We have to say this merits 68%, even if we know it means 70 or 66. You know.
Professor Bell.
Just to add to that, I suppose that one disadvantage of regular revaluation, therefore, is that local authorities will be more open to revenue risk, because, you know, house prices can go down as well as up. If you know that you're basing your forecasts of your local council tax income on 1992 values, well, 1992 values, they won't, you know, they're not going to change. But there is the possibility that house price or volatility in house prices then gets transferred into volatility in council tax revenues.
Okay, thank you, Professor Gibb.
Yeah, and I was actually going to make the same point, that housing markets are volatile, and that's a problem from a revenue risk point of view, but it's also a problem if you don't revalue, and those strange dispersions that take place. I mean, it's not just that an individual property value is now 26 years out of date in terms of where it's been located in that value distribution. It's this sense that neighbourhoods and types of property within local authorities change in their relative value. Nobody would imagine that, you know, this, in the city of Glasgow, the relativities of house prices have remained the same, and that would be a crazy thing to think. So there's a sense that regular evaluation at least allows one to signal and evidence what's going on. The other thing I would say is that Britain remains, with the exception of Ireland, I think, the only country that has a banded system of property taxes. And there clearly were arguments for having bands in the 1990 period when this was all being established. Things to do with the fact that perhaps it's less likely that a property will be misvalued. If it's within a broad band, it's less likely to be paying the wrong rate. So, you know, you can see why people would do those sorts of things. But there's clearly also attractions and advantages to having individual property values for other taxation reasons, for other reasons that you might want to have that information for the buying and selling of homes, for an instance. So, it remained a really convenient way of sorting out the issue. Final thing to say about revaluation and valuation generally, of course, that's about the tax base, and the other side of the coin is the tax rate, the ability to set a tax rate. If you have tax rates effectively fixed, then that will amplify the volatility that changing house prices would have. So there are two parts to the bill that people face.
Yeah, thanks, Professor Gibb. Ruth McGrath, do you want to come back on any of that?
Thank you.
Can I just check then, because as I was hearing the evidence, it seems slightly contradictory, because everyone was saying, look, we need to revalue, it's so out of date. It just has to happen at some point. But then I think Professor Bell was speaking about there are actually dangers in regular revaluation, because it could in theory undermine the stability of the tax base at a local level. So we're kind of hearing, yes, let's revalue, but there's dangers in revaluing at the same time. So a little bit of clarity around that would be quite helpful. But I suppose the follow-up question would be also that, look, the Scottish Government's been clear. It's clearly not going to revalue. These are the proposals it has before it. What's the message that you'd be giving this committee in terms of, well, the revaluation is not going to happen in the short term? Should the Scottish Government be planning for the long term for what revaluation would look like? And should it, as Ruth McGuire suggested, build in a robustness so that once it revisits it once, there's a structure and a process in place so we don't have to return to this to talk about the mechanisms of revaluing going forward?
Certainly go along with that, and in terms of the volatility, house price volatility that I talked about, it's always possible once you have the information to put a brake on how volatile, so you could average the last 5 years, say, and make the case for taking that kind of action. But if you haven't got the information, you don't know what the kind of volatility in the local tax base might be. So the first step, I think, is to collect the information and then hopefully get yourself into that position where you're not coming back regularly and making, you know, discussing council tax bans, which I've got to say I've done for now decades.
Indeed, Professor Bell.
There are other parallels that are more germane than the academic one, which is that kind of regular revaluation and reassessment is now a feature of many, many different aspects of life. I mean, we wouldn't have the current concerns we have about defined benefit pension schemes if it weren't now possible, as happens, to revalue those defined benefit pension schemes and their probable deficit virtually daily. I mean, it used to be the case that people who ran superannuation and pension schemes revalued every year or so, every couple of years. They didn't have this kind of, suddenly the deficit's gone up by 85 million. The more you know, the more you are aware of variation and change, but it's better to know than not to know.
Okay, thank you. Would that anything, Professor Gibb?
Yeah, just a couple of brief points. I mean, one point I think David made and I made in my submission is that one of the arguments in favour of property taxation is that it may be a corrective tool to try to smooth that volatility in house price. And if we get the kind of design of the property tax right, that's one of the reasons why many people support it. The other thing to say is we have had a statutory basis in the past for regular revaluation of our property taxes in the UK under the rates. And we had a terrible record at actually implementing that, both in Scotland and in England, and particularly in England, but you know, not much better here. And that's actually a problem which exists all over the world. Britain has been particularly bad at it though, so we'd have to have pretty belt and braces kind of statutory approach to regular re-evaluation, and even then things might happen.
So I'll give Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, gentlemen. You know, the whole subject of revaluation, and you've touched on many aspects of it today, is a major problem for us as we go forward, because if we do not have the short-term financial planning and the long-term financial planning that's required because of the revaluation situation we find ourselves in, it makes it virtually impossible for some of the local authorities to manage their process as they look at where they're going to be in 5 or 10 years' time, because they don't have that flexibility to look at what has could be achieved or might be achieved as they go forward. So I'd like some sort of views on that. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Who'd like to take that one? No one's making eye contact, Mr. Stewart. Oh, I think Professor Bell might have done there. Yeah, okay.
Well, I mean, long-term planning for any public body, I think, is a major benefit. And in the UK in general, we suffer from short-term view of the world, which doesn't help public bodies to plan. And probably the root cause of that is our annual UK-level budgets, which then cascade down to Scottish Government, down to local authorities in Scotland and so on. So that's on the sort of grant side, which is the more important side of the local authority income. So they can't be sure over the medium and long term where that element of their money is going, and that is, as I say, a function of the way that the somewhat peculiar way that we approach budgeting in the UK. The as far as planning the tax revenues is concerned, you've got three things. You've got the stock of your housing, which is probably predictable. You've got the valuation of that housing, which is open to some kind of volatility, it seems to me, but should be mainly stable. And then you've got decisions that the council, or indeed the government, might make about the rate of council tax, or whether it can go up, whether it can go down, that kind of decision. So I suspect that on the council tax revenue side, a key issue I think is to for local government to be kind of clear over the medium to the longer term where the kind of division of responsibilities between it and central government is going to lie, and that itself has been a bit of a moving target in recent years, and now appears to be moving somewhat again with direct intervention in schools funding.
Okay, thank you. Professor Gibber, you want to add anything to that?
I mean, it kind of leads to another source of volatility, which is this question that I must admit I'm still slightly confused about, which is the possible local income tax, localisation of income tax receipts at local government, because David mentioned the volatility of house prices affecting the tax base, but that's probably less than the volatility of income tax receipts. I think there are a range of other questions about localising income tax receipts in terms of competition and displacement across local authorities and being of benefit to richer local authorities specifically. But it seems to me that's another source of volatility which would impinge on the ability to plan and create a much more kind of, you know, defensive kind of approach.
Okay, thank you, Professor Gibb. Now, we're going to have to move on from revaluation. I spent quite a lot of time on it, but Mr. Simpson, did you have something on revaluation you wanted to
just
add?
Just a follow-up to, again, Professor Gibb. You said that Britain was almost alone in the world by having property bans. So what do other countries do?
They tend to set they'll have a schedule of rates, but they tend to set a given rate at a local level, or they combine it with some other rating levels. So that there would be, you know, in a broader sense, a given local authority would set a tax rate each year and apply it to its property. They would then have a whole series of ways of discounting and supporting and assisting people. So it doesn't follow that everybody pays the same tax rate. There'll be discounts and such like. But so it's more like the notion that Richard was talking about, a discrete tax on a discrete property. And similarly, in the way that's how the domestic rate system essentially worked. You had a valuation and you had a tax rate set by the local authority or combined local authorities, you know, the region and the district. So I think that's kind of what's in one's mind, but there's clearly a range of ways you could do that. But apart from the Irish, I don't think anybody else would set a whole schedule of bans and then locate properties into those wide bans. I think that's right.
Thanks, Professor Gibb. Now, before I want to move on from revaluation, anyone else, Mr. Gibb, revaluation you wanted to speak about?
Sure. I would just say that surely a rolling average of valuations over 5 years would help smooth out volatility and at the same time introduce greater fairness to the system. Rather than an average as such, but a rolling average.
It would give more predictability for local authorities as well, it seems to me, of their tax revenue.
Just moving on from that, we started off by asking if the proposals before us was fairer than what it's moving away from. We got some comments from each of you that yes, it is, but everything's relative in life and it's a bit fairer, but it's not really where you'd like to see fairness moving towards. I think that's a reasonable summation. In terms of fairness, would you take into account the council tax redistribution scheme, reduction scheme rather, which again we have to look at the practicalities of how that will work. But does that make it more fairer? But also in terms of how the monies are to be used, does it make it more redistributive? Because if the £100 million raised across Scotland looks as if it's going to be redistributed across Scotland to areas of particular deprivation, some would argue that's a particularly fair thing to do. And it would appear, looking at the Scottish Government's website, that that's likely to be based on free school meal entitlement in schools. So that £100 million taken by and large from wealthier households but targeted in a focused way to some of the most deprived communities in Scotland would seem to be fairer also. So I suppose I'm trying to tease out the bigger picture when you look at the proposals before us, when you look at the council tax reduction scheme proposals, and you look at potentially, although we need to get more details from the government of course, on the redistributive aspect of it. In that context, I'd quite appreciate some comments on how fair it is, or otherwise.
Can I kick off? I'm not entirely clear about what has been proposed and how that has been amended and what is now proposed. The fundamental that we need to take account of is that whilst we can and do categorise some areas as being more deprived than others, we can go right down to the small data zone, 6,000 odd of them. What we should remember is that an awful lot of people who are poor on low incomes live in areas that are not defined as being deprived data zones and vice versa. There are poor people who live in more privileged areas and there are more privileged people who live in areas that are categorized as poor. So if you use free school meals as a mechanism for redistributing to, say, a particular school, unless that is channeled through to those children in that school who are in receipt of free school meals and are therefore by definition from a low-income household, it's not clear how you achieve very targeted fairness. You may generally favour a particular school, but if you look, for example, Edinburgh, I know best because I live here, and the most recent data from the City Council, I think my recollection, suggested that level of the proportion of children living in poverty in Morningside, Merkeston, which is, by any account, a relatively prosperous area overall, was still about 15% compared to the 30% of children in some of the far more deprived areas. So it's a very complicated chain of causality that takes you from what do we do with that money. I personally think, yes, that a redistribution to areas that are more deprived has a lot to be said for it, but it's not that easily done, and I'm not clear how what I think is being proposed will achieve that.
Professor Kelly. Anyone want to add to that? Professor Gibb first, and then Professor Bell.
Two things I would say. I mean, I think, first of all, there's a kind of criteria problem here in that, it may be fairer, given what Richard's just said about the targeting of that redistribution to schools with, you know, free school meals kind of measurement as a way of allocating funds. But equally, there's this other criteria about local autonomy, and clearly local autonomy is being reduced if this money is being taken by central government down towards the schools directly. You could argue that an alternative way of redistributing is giving local people the power to make those decisions. That's a different way of thinking about that. The other thing I'd say about the council tax reduction scheme is, for those people who are in the higher band properties who are already receiving council tax reduction scheme, that will simply pay the extra that they would be faced with. So it's just this group who are not in council tax reduction at the moment, not qualify for it, up to median income level. That is, I think, as David said, that's quite an extension of the level of means testing. And admittedly, it's a low threshold. It's a 20% taper, which is much lower than many of the other tapers that apply in means testing. But it does bring many more people into that, which, you know, many people would be concerned about, I guess. It's also, you know, quite a, as I mentioned earlier, the issue about take up, which is already low for this scheme. I think there are some concerns about whether people will actually take it up, and so is that as progressive as it might be, as of a more direct way perhaps of trying to address that.
Thank you, Professor Bell.
Just a couple of things. I mean, firstly, you know, the council tax is a mixture of a tax on place and on households, or it relates both to place and to households. And the point that Richard made is that, you know, there, in some places, data zones to be, you know, to take them to their lowest level in Scotland, the zone itself may be classified as poor, but there are probably households within that would not necessarily meet the council tax reduction criteria. I guess in terms of, you know, where are the decisions being made? If you continue to redistribute, then there's a point at which the incentives for richer areas to increase their tax revenues kind of declines. And so there's a question about how that might affect the ability of the willingness of the richer local authorities to strive for more income, ultimately, I suppose, we're not very good at measuring the effectiveness of the money that's been redistributed to schools that have high proportions of pupils with that are getting free school meals. We don't really know, and this, you know, has been a long running problem. Our information on Scottish education isn't that great. It's pretty difficult to track down the evidence that kind of extra spending really works.
Okay, thank you. It would appear as if it has the potential of being redistributive, but Professor Kerley mentioned the 15% of kids in Morningside who would be deemed to be
approximately.
We won't, if it's 13%, we won't haul you over the coals for that. But the idea being is, how do we make sure that the potential to redistribute some of the most vulnerable young people to support them actually happens in reality? And I suppose that then becomes the mechanism by which schools or communities or the local authority has a say in how that money is directed. Understand that discussions are still ongoing with COSLA in relation to how that might happen. I wonder if you have any additional thoughts for the committee and how you think that should happen. Don't have to have, but yeah. Okay, no takers on that. Mr. Whiteman.
Thank you.
What will we do, Professor Kerr?
No, I don't have a thought. Now, I'll repeat again my point that I'm not being facetious when I say exactly what will local authorities be implementing as from April of next year. Will they be redistributing roughly in the order of 100 million to particular schools? And I still think that the only way in which I may be wrong in this completely, I think the only way in which the government can, in short order, affect that change is to simply reduce central grant and assume that local authorities will generate additional local revenue. And then the government will redistribute that money to particular schools in some particular manner. But I'm not at all sure whether the whether Victoria Key has the capability to do that kind of exercise.
Okay, anyone want to add to that before I take Andy Whiteman in? Okay, Andy.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, just following up from that point, I mean, it's the case, isn't it, that non-domestic rating is by statute collected by local authorities but pooled nationally and redistributed, and everybody knows that, and cities like Aberdeen complain because they have a relatively high tax base but they never see it all coming back. Council tax reduction scheme, as I understand it, is funded by Scottish Government funds, and so the redistributive effects of that are undertaken by government Scotland-wide. The problem, it seems to me, with redistributing council tax income is you're redistributing somebody else's income. I mean, it's one thing to have a redistributive scheme with your own resources, or indeed with those which by statute you have called in, i.e. non-domestic rates. It just becomes a little bit more problematic when you're doing it by, for argument's sake, stealth, because we don't have a statutory proposal to do it. Is that, would that be fair?
I think so.
Nodding heads rather than a particular comment.
Yes.
We won't shine a light on you in a moment. Elaine Smith, did you want to come in on that?
Actually, yeah, no, it is to follow up on that point to an extent as well. So in the submission by Professor Gibb, I'm not picking on you because I will come to Professor Bell just in a second. You say that ending the council tax freeze and giving the councils back the power to charge full council tax in second homes is offset by the implementation, and you call it ring fencing of the extra 100 million to a national government priority. And then Professor Bell, you say in your submission, you talk about the local authorities losing control of fire and police services in recent years. You go on to say direct intervention by the Scottish Government in education funding would seem to further erode local authority policy options. So I suppose I want to explore a wee bit further the ring fencing. I don't think we are clear, as Professor Kelly said, on how this might work, because if the authorities raise the tax, then it wouldn't seem that the government can take it. But what they perhaps could do is to lower the grant to offset that raise so that they can then get the funding to redistribute. And I certainly wouldn't argue with redistribution. However, in terms of ring fencing, my understanding of ring fencing would be it would be a government policy and it would be extra money. So, for example, in the past, governments have wanted to provide respite care. So extra money has been identified, and local authorities, if you like, have been an agent of providing that. The government has provided the extra funding. This seems like a sort of reverse ring fencing in some way. So could I have your comments on it?
I would put it as that extra money, that extra £100 million that local authorities are raising as a result of these higher weightings on the bands, they don't have the power to use that money as they see fit. That's the bottom line. So in that sense, it's ring-fenced and it's taken out of their control to be able to use. Maybe ring-fenced is the wrong phrase to use, but the point that we're trying to make, I guess, is that it seems to me that they don't have control over that extra resource, which seems to go against the spirit of a relaxation of the freeze. I know it's only a kind of partial, it's a capped relaxation of the freeze. So that just seems to me to be, and it seems to be inconsistent with this idea that councils will get the power back to set a full council tax on second homes. So it just seems to pull one way and pull in the other way.
Okay. Anyone else want to?
I would just agree that does seem to be pulling back, and as I say, it seems to sit at odds with the consultation about localising income tax collection.
Okay, thank you. Elaine, do you want to come back in on
that?
No,
that's fine.
Can I just check, when we talk about ring fence, and I remember back in the day when I sat on a predecessor local government committee, we looked at the Fairer Scotland Fund as it was at the time, and that was the ring fence monies that local authority had for a whole suite of, I think, agreed priorities with government. And that money was, I get the terminology right, mainstreamed into the core local authority settlement. and then they could then, in theory, spend that and what they decided to spend that on. And I hope I've got the name of that fund correct, but the point I'm making is, are there examples of where there's additional directing of funds from government that local authorities must spend money on, whether that's ring fencing or otherwise, but has there been a relaxing of ring fencing in some respects elsewhere, just so we can get a balance to that? I think that would be one example, but it might be the only example, but are there other examples of a withdrawal or a rolling back of ring fencing for local authority funding?
I'm delving right back into my memory here, but my recollection is that historically there was more ring fencing than there is now, and that the COSLA local authorities objected to the reduction in their freedom to act as a result of this, and the government agreed, and there was a rollback on ring fencing.
I can give a couple of relatively small examples which I think illustrate the difficulty of ring fencing, and indeed to me illustrate the whether it is desirable or not. Firstly, a number of locations within Scotland were given money from what I think at the time was called the Cities Fund. And in general, that was spent on rebranding exercises for various cities. Those of you who know Aberdeen will recall Aberdeen City and Shire. Edinburgh substituted the strapline of the festival city for a kind of expensively designed set of what were meant to represent bridges. I'm not good on design, but they didn't speak bridges to me. And that money was washed out the door in, I forget what order it was. You know, it wasn't a great deal, but by its very nature, ring fencing is indiscriminate about the value. It's just here you are as a chunk of money, spend it in this way. More seriously, there's, as part of the recognition of poor health conditions throughout Scotland, local authorities were required to, at one point, to appoint health liaison or health promotion staff. I can't recall what the title was. They were all given ring-fenced money to do that. They all did that. It ran out at the end of 3 years, and most of them kind of quietly terminated the appointments. And last time I spoke to anybody in Health Scotland, there were only about four or five such posts or units surviving throughout the country, because the local authorities thought they were not particularly effective means of spending money to achieve an object that we would all agree upon. They just thought there were better ways of achieving that.
Okay, that's quite important for balance. So we can raise concerns about additional direction of funds from nationally for local authority funding and ring fencing. But over the last 10 to 15 years, there has been a move away from ring fencing in some circumstances. I think that's quite important for balance. Kenneth Gibson.
Yeah, thanks for that, convener. I mean, it was the famous historic concordat of November 2007, which abolished some 60 ring fence funds, as I recall. I mean, I want to look at the figures, actually, of where this £100 million is going to come from and the mechanisms thereby. I mean, if you look at the figures from Spice, basically, they say that, for example, Edinburgh City will raise £15.6 million of this, whereas Dundee will be able to raise only 1.4 million. Now, the Scottish Government has obviously said that this £100 million will be hypothecated for education. So if we assume that the mechanism for redistributing that, because the council taxes aren't going to be shifted around, is the grant formula, one would assume that Edinburgh would get significantly less than 15.6 million and Dundee significantly more. But at the same time, the Scottish Government appears to have said that no local authorities will be any worse off. So that seems to me a rather strange statement, because one would assume that if, in actual fact, Edinburgh was still able to keep its £15.6 million in another format, but money was going additionally to schools in Dundee but less to Edinburgh, what that would mean is that Edinburgh would, in effect, have additional monies for the non-hypothecated funds, whereas Dundee would have less. So what's your understanding of that? Your head there, Professor Bell.
David will answer.
Well, Professor Bell.
So I understand the point. I'm not quite sure that I have a very clear solution. Might it be that Aberdeen, say, although it, you know, income is is being gained overall as a result of this. It will get its 10 million or whatever. Much of that will be taken away through the grant, but maybe not all of it will be taken away. So it might be argued that Aberdeen is no worse off. Does that seem plausible? But certainly Dundee gets considerably more than the addition it raised, because it get it raised domestically, because its grant will be increased. So there will be a complicated set of steps, it seems to me, to ensure that no local authority is worse off. But of course, you know, they will be getting a standstill budget at least, which is what they would have got had the ratios not increased.
The point I'm making is that although they may not be worse off in total, if one local authority is getting significantly more in its education budget, then it's going to have to make significant reductions in other areas of its budget, whereas if another local authority is not getting all of the additional money that's been raised through its education, then it will have a significant increase in the other areas in which it can spend its money. Is this not a concern, and is this a thing which should be avoided in terms of this policy?
Professor Kerley, do you want to?
I think that this. If I'm hearing what you're saying, Mr. Gibson, there's an element of a local authority doesn't have an education budget. As if you think in terms of ring fencing, which this is, the only element of an education budget predetermined before anybody starts working through. Now, nobody does zero-based budgeting. They pretend to, but they don't. This will be the only element that somebody has to write in. You know, the figures are, when you compare the suggested figure against the total education spend in every local authority, it is a relatively small amount of money. So the local authority can make choices about what it puts into its budget and identify this as a part of what it is doing for onward redistribution to some schools. If all schools get in, you know, we'd need to work our way through what proportion of the children in each school and across the authority as a whole are entitled to free school meals before we would see any kind of correlation. I mean, it's when you look at different aspects of local authority data, you find they often don't actually correlate that well.
Yeah, I think you're making something very straightforward, very complicated. Edinburgh is going to raise 15.6 million. It's not going to get 15.6 million in education, but if it's going to keep the same amount of money overall that it is raised, surely that puts additional pressure on other local authority services within those local authorities that get more than they're raising in funds to spend on education through this hypothecation.
Yes.
And is that something you should think should be done or should not be done, is what I'm trying to get clarified. In other words, do you think this money should be additional and hypothecated to education but recirculated across Scotland, or should there be, or should it be that no local authority is indeed any worse off, which actually means that the non-schools budgets will indeed be worse off in poorer areas?
Answer that. And other than the general principle that it should be a matter of choice for respective local authorities to determine what they spend on, that's conditioned by legacy, and it's conditioned by circumstance in one local authority and surrounding local authorities. You know, Edinburgh spends significantly more on, say, culture,
of course,
than do the surrounding Lothians.
Well, indeed, it gets more income from that as well. But what this would mean is, if there's no change, then the local authorities already more prosperous will become even more prosperous, and the gulf between them and poor authorities will widen rather than diminish, which is, of course, the reverse of what the policy is trying to achieve.
Can I just check for clarity, Mr. Gibson, because my understanding is it's been intimated that the reason local authorities will keep all the cash they raise from that £100 million is there's no mechanism to take council tax revenues off of local authorities in the first place. So by definition, if it's £100 million additional money, no local authority can be any worse off, and it's about the distribution formula for money coming from the centre into either revenue budgets or direct to schools that we need more information on. Would that?
Yes, that's the thing that we've had
to change.
Yeah.
I'm just making sure that I was actually understanding that fully. Any additional comments on that before I move on to some of my other colleagues for an additional question? No. Okay. Now, I think Alexander Stewart indicated, and I'd just give you a roll call, a name call. Graham Simpson, Andy Whiteman, I've got you down for questions, okay? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Following on from what you've just said, the individuals who are going to receive the bill that's going to tell them they're paying more tax, they will have the assumption that may well be going on to the services and facilities within their own area. That may not be the case under the situation and the circumstances. The control of the council to manage that situation will be, there'll be a tension potentially in that whole process. And then we have the situation, as Mr. Gibson's talking about, where it may well be the case that there'll be potentially winners and losers in some local authorities. And the timescale that we have to do all that is quite tight. You know, how do we square that circle?
Early, you broke ranks first.
Not my problem. I think it's there is more than one circle to square. First, there is this and this form of proposed redistribution here and the relevering. There is there are local authority elections occurring, as you know, in May of next year, and between the decision on council tax levels and therefore the impact on households, which has to take account of the reproportioning, will be at most a 3-month period, so March, April, not even quite that. I think there will be an enormously frantic rush during that period. There will also be a lot of extremely heated, angry meetings in church halls and school halls, the length and breadth of Scotland. And if you take my point about the distribution of property assets, you know, that may be less frantic in some areas than others, but even in areas that might otherwise appear to benefit, it's going to be problematic. I'm not technically able to know whether all of these, the necessary different decisions can be made in time and implemented in time.
Okay. Anyone want to add to that, Professor Bell?
I suspect Professor Gibbon may make the same point, but how are we going to contact all the people who may be eligible for additional council tax reduction between now and the date that the council tax bills go out? I'm not clear how these people are going to be identified.
The recurring theme we've had from evidence this morning. Professor Gibb, you have a name check? Do you want to add anything?
Yeah, I just see what he said.
Oh, right, okay. Graham Simpson.
Thanks, Convener. So all we have in front of us at the moment is a statutory instrument to increase council tax across the country in four bands, which has been imposed by the government. What we don't know is a whole set of assumptions, which we've talked about this morning, about what happens to that extra money. We actually don't know, because nobody's spelled it out. We assume it's going to education. We are assuming they might use school meals as a factor in distributing it. We do not know how they're going to distribute it. We don't know how they're going to get the money from councils. Do you think the government should have got its story straight, its act together, before introducing the SSI?
So there's a lot of things that apparently we don't know. Do we know some of that? And if so, could you be clear about that? And what are the unknowns? So, because the things that we're unclear of, we'll obviously ask the Scottish Government during our consideration of evidence in relation to this.
I think clarity on the distribution, or the mechanism for distribution, is very important. I've got to say I wasn't entirely clear how it would be directed, so I think there's that. And I guess, following on from the discussions that we've already had, how will the grant from the Scottish Government to the local authorities be adjusted? Because, as we know, the Scottish Government has no power to take away the additional council tax revenue from the local authorities, so it will all come through this adjustment. What is the exact mechanism for that adjustment to happen?
Okay, anyone want to add to that?
Okay. The only thing I'd say is, I think there's a question in all of this as to whether this is the end of the story. Is there further local tax reform in the offing? Are we simply stopping at this point? Because we have, you know, there's been some discussion in sort of political circles that this may not be the end of the process. So I think that's a real uncertainty because, you know, simply ceasing the reform process now would seem fairly disappointing in some respects after the work that's been done, and also because of the things we've been saying about the nature of the proposed SI. So I think that's an important issue to at least, you know, consider and put back to the government.
Yeah, that's helpful. And again, just for clarity, so the two aspects that we need more information on is the distribution mechanism for the monies raised and how grant adjustments will be impacted. Those are the two things that would be good to have more information on. In terms of it being imposed, I suppose the Scottish Government was pretty clear that this was going to happen. It was in the manifesto. So, I don't think there was a lack of awareness amongst the public that this was going to happen, and it's pretty clear that the money will be spent on education. That's all public information, yeah?
That's why I choose not to answer your question in the way in which you couched it. Governments make decisions because they have the votes to make those decisions, and that's life. The other factor that we're not aware of is the extent to which different local authorities will themselves propose to use their reintroduced freedom to set a higher rate of council tax across the piece, which will mean that, you know, if you look at the overall figures, that means the highest banded properties will be potentially looking at an increase next year of in the order of 25%. That is a direct consequence of a several year freeze. You know, in every setting, in every country, when you freeze an otherwise rising price level for a period of years, there is a huge jump upwards when you make the change.
That's helpful, and actually it leads us in, is it specifically on that, because it was leading us into our next question, which was about the 3% cap in increased council tax, but I'll maybe take Andy Whiteman in first as a supplementary.
Yes, I just wanted to follow up on the question of kind of public information and awareness. I mean, notwithstanding what the convener said about the words in the SNP manifesto, I'm not sure that 2.4 million households did appreciate that, or indeed are appreciating what the changes are. I mean, I'm getting constituents writing to me in Band E properties that are worth less than Band B properties, appealing, for example, and they won't have any success in that, of course. But I'm just wondering, what's your sense of what we might need to do, or indeed how the public might respond to the fact that by February, March next year, the multiplier will be in place, plus a possible new rate will have been applied, and the public won't be terribly clear about why their bills are rising. And we have evidence from Les Robertson in the next session saying that local government will not be in a position to accept applications to reduce the charge until after the annual billing process. In other words, council tax reduction, new council tax reduction eligibilities will have to be applied for retrospectively. So there's a potential for quite a bit of muddle amongst perhaps significant number of people. How do you think we can mitigate that?
Okay, who'd like... There's a lot of ringing of hands going on from our witnesses this morning. Professor Bell.
Between social media and the TV advertising campaign at the moment, but we need really. I mean, it is a serious point, because people will get a shock because they've been used to almost 10 years of a flat bill, and all of a sudden it will hike up quite a bit. So the government really does need to put its mind to getting this information out. I'm not the best person to advise them on that, but it seems to me that you do need to work both on the straight increase in the council tax bill, but also on the council tax reduction, because although it may occur retrospectively, you've got to get the information out there for people to gear themselves up to think, my income is a bit higher than the old council tax reduction, but now it qualifies under the new scheme.
Anyone want to add anything to that, Professor Gibb?
I suppose this is an opportunity to actually get a lot more information out about the reduction scheme than otherwise would probably have occurred because of the short time horizons that are there. Perhaps there are things like ready reckoners that could be used to help people get an easily accessible sense of what their gross income for benefit purposes actually is. There's been quite a lot of useful work done with that in terms of how housing benefit over many years. So I'm sure DWP will have information on those kinds of things, which are actually very helpful just to get somebody over the first hurdle of thinking about whether they should be applying or not.
Any witnesses want to add anything to that? Okay. Professor Kelly, did you want to?
Well, a small point would be that if there is an enhanced form of mitigation for some households, and it's not a large number of households, it kind of begs a lot of questions about how are people made aware of that. Now, it strikes me that without being incredibly intrusive into individual households, that has to be a kind of sheep dip model of awareness, i.e. press and television advertising, possibly social media advertising. I'm not at all sure where the payment for that would come from and the form of it. I assume it should rest with the government because it is a countrywide arrangement and you want a common, similar countrywide message going out in various forms. That can't be a cheap exercise. I don't mean can't as in it shouldn't be. I mean it. Questioning, you know, it's going to be a few mil in itself.
And I think, again, that's been the recurring theme throughout your evidence in relation to how we get the message out there in relation to council tax reduction scheme and make sure those who are not already in the system getting that they can apply for it. Maybe one final question. It was said in the answer to the last question that, you know, households across Scotland have been used to static council tax bills for many years and that's going to change. Obviously, the Scottish Government has said that there will be a cap in relation to councils being able to set council tax at a higher level at 3%. I wonder if you've got any thoughts on how that would actually work. Professor Kerley.
Authority will start from the presumption that they would try and hit the 3% figure, or 2.99, whatever is achievable. That would at least be the modelling that must be going on at the moment, at least from the conversations I've had. There will, of course, be political decisions to be made in different councils about whether we do that or whether we try and get the lowest increase of any council throughout Scotland. How that emerges is very much how we know budgetary decisions and processes emerge in different councils, whether majority, of which there are few, or shared administrations. And it's a kind of trade-off. But I'm reckoning most of them will go for the near 3% figure.
I suppose, I mean, how the Scottish Government stops council setting an increase of 4% is how a cap is enforced. My apologies for not making that clear.
Reduce grant by individual council, which would be a variant on where the... I mean, you know, we talked about ring fencing being abolished in the historic Concordat of 2007. We forget that the council tax so-called freeze was actually ring fencing of government money. It was an incentive to not increase the council tax because the government has no statutory powers to freeze council tax across Scotland. It can, however, act against individual authorities.
This is the reinvention of the £70 million each year that local authorities got into the revenue grant to encourage them to set a 0% tax increase each year. Yeah. So some mechanism around that is what you would anticipate. Do you want to add anything to that?
I've just added that probably, given the state of the economy at the moment, that will mean increasing real burden of council tax in that not that many households are seeing their income increase faster than 3% at the moment, or as fast as 3% even.
Okay, thank you. A couple of bits for supplementaries. My vice convener did intimate first, Elaine.
If it's specifically on that, I had a slightly wider supplementary.
Okay, Andy Whiteman.
The last time we did sort of rate capping was in the 80s, where we did it under the Rates Act of 1984, and it was a statutory thing. Do you think there's any merit in considering a statutory rate cap, if that's what government wants to achieve? It would be a Yeah, no, that's my question.
That legacy of the rate capping legislation, which as a councillor I was subjected to, is at the root of the incentive payment to hold council tax steady. It was, you know, the amount of council tax substitution money, about 70 mil, was, in my calculation back in 2007, roughly in the order of what a court would have considered to be a reasonable increase, roughly 3%. I don't favour a statutory cap. I think it can be achieved in other ways. I personally wouldn't seek to do it, but I think it will be and can be achieved in other ways. It's an extremely messy exercise. And last time round, 20 Lord years ago, it was hard work for everybody involved.
Professor Gibb?
Well, I mean, the other side of the coin, though, is that if you don't have open, transparent mechanisms, you have negotiations between the likes of COSLA and the government that go on for a lot of time. We don't know what's necessarily going on in those negotiations. There's a lack of that transparent formality, I suppose. So I'm not saying either outcome is necessarily the desirable one, but certainly a more open way of dealing with this would be better than a less open one.
Elaine Smith for the final question of this session.
Thank you very much, Convener. So we are looking at the statutory instruments, one of my colleagues pointed out, and that is to tweak the bans, and that is what we really have to report on at the end of the day as a committee. And I think it would be hard personally to argue against doing that in terms of even your evidence today. I think everyone said it's slightly a fairer way to do things. However, I suppose the final question for me would be that, and Professor Kerr mentions it in the submission, basically, Professor Kerr, you say the Scottish Government proposals for changes to council tax do not significantly address the concerns with Scotland's local property taxes raised by the Commission on Local Tax Reform. Do you have an opinion on why, having had the Commission on Local Tax Reform, the Government has decided not to implement that and has decided instead to tweak? And I'm asking about opinion, obviously, I understand that.
No, I don't have an opinion on that.
Okay.
I have my views on it, but I don't have an opinion on
it. I don't think I'll
take
that one either.
Professor Gibb, do you have a view or an opinion?
Well, only what I said in the written okay. Evidence, so okay. I wouldn't need to repeat that, I don't think.
It might be worth noting as we draw this session to an end that there's a debate tomorrow afternoon in the Scottish Parliament in relation to local authority funding. So I suspect this will run and this isn't the end point of what's going to happen. I suspect all three of you will be back in front of us before too long to give us your valued views in the next round of changes. Can I thank all three of you for coming along this morning? It's very helpful in relation to our consideration of the statutory instrument before us. And we'll close that particular evidence session there, and we'll suspend briefly to get the next panel of witnesses ready. Thank you. Okay, good morning everyone and welcome back. We continue agenda item one this morning, which is subordinate legislation taking evidence on the council tax substitution of proportion Scotland order 2016, and we now move to our second panel of witnesses. So can I welcome five witnesses this morning: Joan Hewson, Scottish Association President and Assessor for Lothian Valuation Board; Les Robertson, Chair Scottish Revenues and Benefits Forum and Service Manager Revenues for Fife Council; David Thomason, Scottish Assessors Association; David Mulhuish, Director, Scottish Property Federation; and Don Peebles, Head of SIPFA Scotland. Thank you, all of you, for coming along this morning. It's been indicated that three of you will make some short opening statements to kind of set the scene before we move to questions. And I hope I've got this right. I'll just take them in the order it was intimated to myself. Joan Hewson, I think you're making the first opening statement.
Yes, I am. Thank you. Good morning, all. The IRV welcomes the opportunity to attend this evidence session. The Institute is the only professional body in the United Kingdom which specialises in the law and practice of local authority revenues and local taxation, together with appeals, reliefs and benefits which support these processes. As members within both the public and the private sector, including ratepayers and their agents, Institute members are engaged in property valuation, local taxation collection, the appeals process, advising and representing ratepayers, and financial management within local government. The Institute represents the professional interests of its members who work within this very broad church. We have a very well-supported and dynamic Scottish Association of the Institute, which seeks to effect development and change within the Institute's professional sphere of interest through dialogue with key stakeholders. The Institute acts as a consultative body for government and takes an active part in consultations, evidence sessions and dialogue as required and appropriate. The IRV Scotland note that the majority of the respondents to the 2015 Commission on Local Tax Reform considered that the current council tax system was not fit for purpose in its present state. The main recommendation from the Commission was that the present council tax system must end, and predominant view was that a wholesale revaluation of council tax was required, and ideally based on regular and frequent updated valuations. It was further concluded that any system should be seen as fair and acceptable to the public and more progressive than the existing council tax. It is with this clear view in mind that the answers to the questions raised in the current consultation have been considered by us. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting Scottish Property Federation to give evidence today. We're an industry body, so we have a wide range of corporate members. So there'll be developers, there'll be investors, professional advisors and so forth, some of whom were involved in the Commission for Local Tax Reform, along with some members of this committee. So our interest principally in council tax reform is, firstly, our members will be involved across the range of property product, residential, commercial and so forth. So it's to the people who ultimately will occupy and be paying the tax. Second, as well, there's a wider question which this begs about local authority funding, of course, and a lot of our members will work closely with local authorities in the pursuit of economic development, planning, building standards, and so forth. And there's a general feeling that there's a resource issue in the local authority sector from our perspective. So we've outlaid our main points of what we see in council tax reform. I think we were more for reform, not too dissimilar to what the government have proposed, but we do agree with some of the comments which Jones just made, that we think if you want a fair tax base, a wholesale revaluation is appropriate, especially given we're a quarter of a century on from the last one, in order to reflect the modern residential market.
Thank you. And Don Peebles?
Good morning. Thanks very much also for the opportunity to come along today to talk about local tax. Some of us, maybe many of us, have been here before having discussions on local taxation, and I look forward to continuing that this morning with the committee. Maybe picking up, first of all, from what was said in the previous session, and also in the absence of a written submission from me, I think it's probably important to appreciate that this is the first phase of reform. When the Scottish Government made an announcement earlier this year, they made it clear that there was going to be modification to council tax, but that was actually going to be also supplemented by an initiative which was actually going to link the new income tax powers to local government funding, which was going to be in the form of an assignation of income tax. We await details on that. That's still to be forthcoming. I think that wider context is important because the Commission on Local Tax Reform, which has already been mentioned and which I had the pleasure of actually serving on, concluded that no single tax instrument could actually deliver fairness. So I think it's crucial that actually considering the statutory instrument this morning, that we think of the wider possibilities and the issues which will be coming down the line as well. But to actually commence a discussion this morning, I thought it might be useful to actually just set out what SIPFA has actually said previously and actually has said to the Commission on Local Tax Reform. The paper that we submitted to the Commission last year can in effect be distilled into three what I think are fundamental points. The first one being that the view of SIPFA that local tax should be set and it should be raised locally without any interference from government centrally. That's a significant point in principle that we've adhered to. Secondly, we actually think that the base for tax, the tax base, should be current. And what that means in practicality for a properly based taxation is there should be revaluation on an ongoing basis. Again, that's already been mentioned to, and no doubt we'll actually come to that as well. But thirdly, we actually thought there was actually scope to enhance accountability. And there's two issues associated with that. On a practical level, we thought there was opportunity actually to disengage the council tax bill from the bill for Scottish Water. Now, we weren't saying that council should stop collecting monies on behalf of Scottish Water, but there was confusion and continues to be confusion in the eyes of the public about the bill that they actually receive. And secondly, and perhaps more fundamentally as part of that third point, now there was opportunity, and I'd like to think that opportunity can still be taken to actually think about a wider range of discretionary tax powers for local government than the one that's usually referred to, and perhaps the one that's easiest to identify with is a tourist tax, and that's something which I think would be useful to consider as well. If I actually contrast those three points to what came through in the statutory instrument, what I do notice is that the freeze has been removed, which I think everybody actually welcomes, but it's introduced a limit of 3%, and already we're hearing the word cap mentioned, and I've heard that mentioned this morning. Secondly, there's no indication of revaluation, which indicates to me that the current 1991 base will be maintained. And thirdly, a mechanism for the use of local resources for national policy purposes. And that feels different to me. It's an area where we haven't been at all, is my understanding. And I think it's crucial, again, to come back in my final comment, that the Commission did conclude that local tax should be a contribution to the general funding of local authorities. What this does, perhaps even inadvertently, is actually assign specific monies to almost the characteristics of a charge for services, in this case education. But my key point that I actually want to get across, convener, is that I think it's important to consider there's going to be a wider set of reforms that are coming down the line. We don't have sight of what those actually are at the moment, and whilst it's right to focus on what is a modest set of reforms at this stage, the risk in focusing only on the statutory instrument is that we end up having a modest discussion and there are wider and bigger issues to consider going forward.
Okay, thank you very much for all our witnesses for giving their opening statements. We'll move shortly to questions from other members in a second. I'm sure they want to raise much of what you've said in your opening statements there. But can I start with a very straightforward question? Is the proposals as set by the Scottish Government, is it fairer than the current situation? And if so, in what ways is it fairer?
I think in our submission we said to you we thought that the sort of 3-to-1 proportionate cap which was imposed since the 90s was way past its sell-by date and needed to go. So in that sense, it's a step towards a fairer spread of burden. I also said as well we thought that the bandings of could be added to with another couple of bands at the higher end just to reflect better the market. So I would say it's a step in the right in the direction of making a fair and more proportionate system. I don't think we'd go much further than that at this stage.
Okay. Anyone like to add to that, Mr. Robertson?
The answer is yes, it is fairer, notwithstanding the issues without a revaluation, which I think is sort of a crux to this, that if you want a taxation to be properly fair, it should actually reflect what a property's value is now, not what it was 25 years ago. But overall, yes, the thesis of higher band properties should pay more. Yeah, I think that's fairer.
Okay, and before we move on, any other... Don't feel that every witness has to answer every question. We would be here all day, but anyone else want to add to that?
We probably all concur that it's less regressive. Whether it's much fairer is debatable. But yes, it's we can't get away from the fact that the people in the highest banded houses will pay more, and that is appropriate.
We are going to very quickly move on to revaluation from my fellow MSP colleagues. So I just want to cover a couple of bases first. In relation to fairness, do you want to make any comment? You don't have to. In relation to the council tax reduction scheme as proposed, or how the money is intended to be spent, just so we can clear that bit up, and then we can move on to the next set of questions. Any comments in relation to that, Mr. Robertson?
Yeah, obviously being the sort of expert on council tax reduction, and the first thing to make clear is everybody who's currently receiving council tax reduction will be protected from the changes to the ratios because of the way the scheme works. So all of the lowest income households will actually receive protection, because if everything else is equal, if your council tax goes up, your council tax reduction goes up. So they're protected. The 54,000 households, I've made in my submission, that's the estimate for the Scottish Government, there will be a rebilling exercise required. We probably could accept applications in advance, but how do you get that out there? And obviously the easiest way to do that is that you put the details in along with your council tax bill. Is one of the easiest ways to actually do that, and it wouldn't cost that much more to put an extra sheet of paper in. I wish to apply my circumstances. What the professors were saying earlier on, it's very easy to produce a ready reckoner, because your income is going to be at this level, you will qualify and you will not get the ratio. So if you wish to apply, please tick this box, sign it and send it back to us, and then we will take the necessary steps to contact you.
Sorry to show my ignorance, a ready reckoner, could you say a little bit more about what that actually is?
Just basically, if you're affected by the increase in charge, and I think we have the technology where we could actually target that to band E to H properties, so we could identify them in advance for annual billing, and therefore then put an insert with that and saying, here's a ready reckoner. So if your income is this level, you could be exempt from this by completing this form. I think that's quite a straightforward way of doing it.
Okay, and would that be 32 versions of that across Scotland, or would there be a one pro forma that is in every council tax bill across Scotland? How would that work? Because times 32 seems pretty bureaucratic. Is that just how it has to work, because council tax is organised locally?
My view is that it should actually be done by the Scottish Government and given to councils to put in with their bills. But as you're aware, yes, there are 32 different council tax bills that go out at the moment, each in its own format, which is maybe not ideal.
Okay. Now, going to move on. Any additional comments from witnesses before we move on? Okay. Graeme Simpson.
We've spoken a lot about revaluation, and most of the witnesses seem to favour a national revaluation. So can I just kick off with a practical question, and based on your professional expertise, how difficult would that be to carry out nationally, and how long would it take?
David Thompson?
I should speak on behalf of the association, and that one is the assessors that will do the job. That's a chicken and egg question to some extent, so you'll excuse what might appear to be a fudged answer. The length of time and the difficulty would very much depend on the form. We've already heard in the earlier session discussion on banded revaluations or discrete valuation revaluations. We may come to it later. I don't necessarily see them as absolutely distinct and apart. But if assessors are required to value property, each individual property to a more or less exact value, that's a far more difficult task than doing a banded exercise. So it's quite clear that a banded exercise would take less time and less resource. Our experience of completing a revaluation is that it's taken 2 to 3 years to do a complete national revaluation. there have been exercises undertaken during the Commission's considerations, whereby we've already had mentioned this morning some statistical elements may be introduced to the system. Now, our experience is not in having used such statistical models. However, there is the scope there to consider these either for implementation within assessors' offices or perhaps in partnership with the academic bodies who have been involved in these property analyses to date.
Just before that, do you want to go back on that, Graham Simpson?
Well, is there anyone else who wants to answer that?
Yes.
Well, you said 2 to 3 years.
Two to 3 years. It could be done in probably shorter time with additional mass appraisal type resource that obviously has perhaps funding or partnership implications.
What? Explain that, mass appraisal.
Mass appraisal is the term used generally in the industry for systems whereby a whole batch of data, physical attributes and sales data are entered into a system, and a series of algorithms are derived and applied to apply at least an initial valuation to properties, but perhaps in themselves don't have sales evidence. Now, if the data is captured and used properly, this should be able to speed up the valuation process for a significant proportion of the property portfolio across the country. Now, as it stands, assessors currently have elements of mass appraisal in most of their internal systems. However, there are, and you've heard it spoken about earlier this morning, advances in these appraisal systems, new algorithms, new systems, and these could be investigated as to see how much use they could be to assist with a national revaluation.
Other witnesses had wanted to come in and give a comment. Don Peebles, I know you wanted to add to that.
Convener, yeah, the other point of the question was on the cost. To maybe revert to the evidence that was taken by the Commission on Local Tax Reform, the range of costs that were indicated by witnesses to the Commission was from £5.5 million to around £8.5 million, which was the upper figure that was actually quoted. Most witnesses to the Commission indicated that as far as technology was concerned, it now exists to enable that to supplement what David actually said, and there was no question that it could not actually be done. The additional point I would maybe make, Convener, is that at the moment all local authorities are required to value their social housing stock. So valued social housing stock actually sits on council balance sheets at the moment. So to a large extent, we're maybe talking about private dwellings that are actually out there. Again, I'd maybe refer the committee to the work that the Commission undertook on revaluation, which was based on a sample of 8 local authorities, and the figures which emerged make for interesting reading. It concluded that politically there'd be a significant challenge in actually going forward with revaluation, but as far as technology and cost was concerned, it's certainly achievable.
Any other witnesses want to come in on that? George Houston?
I think we have to kind of bear in mind, obviously, revaluation, we'd dearly love to see this. And I think, I said in my submission, as a first stage, you know, altering the amount we're paying per band is a good option to start with. If we had a planned timetable, I think that would be the, by far the best. So there are things that we could be doing in the interim. And one of my other submissions was about, you know, picking up alterations to properties. I mean, you've got properties that have been grossly extended for 23 years and are still paying in the band of the value of their original house. That kind of stuff could be maybe brought in 1 year, and then the following year you bring in a revaluation. All the time you're building the data and going forward. The one thing, obviously, as well, you know, we have given, our evidence was given from various different sources on the discrete values. And Northern Ireland did it to discrete value, but what they were actually valuing in a very highly increasing property market at that point in time, where the properties, by the time the date of their tone date, the date when their valuation was taking effect, and the notices going out 2 years later, the properties had actually increased by 50%. So they had very, very little in the way of appeals because it was such a people all thought, oh, I'm undervalued, I won't appeal. But, you know, people don't realise that it's based in 2 years earlier. So it's just, if we are going down a revaluation route, again, I would say the same as Dawn, you know, look at the previous submissions that came out from the last consultation, because it was, I think there was a lot of evidence based on that.
David Milhouse, do you want to add?
Just very quickly, I mean, I do think the evidence is there and can be done quickly. I mean, the Registers of Scotland produce mass sales evidence data on a monthly basis across the country, broken down by local authority level. They can do that according to different bands and that. So I think that kind of data could greatly assist the sort of mass appraisal techniques which David was referring to. So, you know, I think the possibilities are certainly there. And if you're in a situation where I think nearly 60% of properties are in the wrong band, either upwards or downwards, then it's just a situation that shouldn't be allowed to continue.
Mr. Robertson, do you want to add?
Not being an expert in the field, but I would just suggest there are other countries that use self-assessment. They just return a form and say, what is the value of my property? And that is used. Because obviously, if you're self-assessing, if you put it too low, but that's the value that gets displayed then when you come to sell the property. It may be something that the committee would want to consider.
Okay, and a couple of supplementaries in relation to this. Elaine Smith and then Kenneth Gibson.
Thanks. It's actually back to what David Thompson said at the beginning. I think Mr. Milhouse takes us back to that. You said, if I heard you correctly, that it would be more difficult to do a full assessment of each property, but it's easier to do a banding assessment. But can you explain how you could put properties into bands if there wasn't a full property assessment?
Yeah, as we did in 1992 and 93, almost a first pass valuation is sufficient in most cases for bands. If you, for instance, you get a house which is broadly between £140,000 and £180,000 fits nicely into a band. You don't need to spend any more time on that. Whereas if we have to pin down, is that 150 or 155, then it would take some extra effort. The information provided to the taxpayer might also have to take a different form, because we may have to provide more justification for such an exact valuation.
However, Mr. Milhouse seemed to say that actually a lot of that information is already there, so it might not be too difficult to evaluate housing.
I take with some caution external people who are not necessarily administrators exaggerating the ease of valuing property. As I think it was already alluded to in the first session this morning, what someone sees as 140,000 might, someone else might see it as 150, and someone else might see it as 155. The market is not a science. So going back to the evidence that was presented to the Commission, the statistical and mass appraisal systems were identified as being useful in a lot of instances, but they didn't address large chunks of the property market or large chunks of geographical area. So there's still very much an intelligence needs to be overlaid on such apparently simple statistical modelling.
Anyone else want to add to that? Okay, do you want to follow up on that, Ellen?
No,
Kenneth Gibson.
Thanks very much, Convener. I mean, I think given what the academics said, and I do think you've been very diplomatic in your response there, Mr. Thompson. I mean, I was quite shocked when you said 2 to 3 years to do a complete evaluation. Now, is that basically about lack of resources and staff? And are we talking about individual houses or bandings there? If it was bandings, how long would it take to do a complete evaluation? And lastly, I did suggest in the previous session, so save me having to ask it again, distinct from this question, would a 5-year rolling average of valuations reduce volatility? Academics seem to think so, but what's your professional view?
Turning to the first question, which was, if you remind me, sorry?
Yeah, sorry. Basically, you said 2 to 3 years to get a complete evaluation. Is that banding or individual properties?
The association has always taken the view that a conventional revaluation to a banded system would take approximately 2 years. Now, that again depends on the breadth of the bands and so on and so forth. But 2 years is a reasonable estimate of how it would take. Remembering, of course, that a valuation has to be completed in advance of billing, and the current legislation requires draft values to be laid approximately 6 months before the bills go out. So the process itself has some inherent time in it. So a banded system, we've always suggested that we could complete that in two years. A discrete one may take us a bit longer. Because we've never done that, and because we're not sure how useful other tools would be, I would be reluctant to put a hard and fast figure on it, but it would certainly be, I would suggest, in excess of 2 years.
So, yeah, and that's because of staff and resources, or just
it's partly that there is just a finite time in completing the process. There are only a certain number of skilled valuers across Scotland.
Of course, appreciate that.
Whether they're employed in assessors' offices or not, so there's a fixed element or fixed number of surveyors who you would presumably want to be signing off values. Mm-hmm. But as I say, that there are time lags in the system. For instance, a house sale today will not be public for 2 to 3 months. Mm-hmm. That then has to be transferred to the assessors for them to start to analyse that. And certainly, if you're trying to value at a point in time, you will certainly want to see a breadth of sales evidence both sides of that. So it's helpful to have a time lag after the point of valuation in which to arrive at your values.
Sorry, and lastly, convener, is that an argument then for rolling averages? If you do bring in a revaluation at some point in the future, would rolling averages in terms of cost, would that help if that was built into the system? Or is that impractical?
For me, that's a completely separate question. Mm-hmm. I think I go back to the point the academics made. The revaluation sets your base. How you charge on that base are matters for politics or for finance officers, but the revaluation, which is what assessors do, is only establishes the base. To do that, a rolling annual revaluation, in my view, would not be as simplistic as was suggested earlier. That said, if the systems were put in place and the experience were to be gained, the process may be implemented over a period. A charging mechanism using valuations over 5 years is a completely different structural model, which I wouldn't have any expertise in.
Okay, Tom, that's very helpful. Those are the witnesses that are not assessors. Would you want to make any comments on that?
Yeah, I'm quite happy. I mean, it's like what David says about it, wouldn't never be straightforward in point in time, but if you never start, then you'll never redress this situation of, you know, coming towards two-thirds of properties in Scotland being charged on the wrong basis. I think the registers stuff would get you somewhere down the line and give you a start, and I wasn't thinking of anything other than a banded system, to be honest. And 5 year was suggested, or rolling revaluations. I'm not sure you'd need to do residential revaluations as frequently as you have to do the commercial business rates equivalent. I think every 10 years would be fine. But I think the problem is, if you don't start, then you've got this recurring form. And, you know, most political parties in this room have been in government somewhere in Britain at some stage. To my knowledge, apart from the distinctive Northern Irish situation, only Wales has done this. So, you know, it seems to be a particular nettle that there's an unwillingness to grasp. And I think the problem is only going to get worse the longer we put it off.
Anyone else want to add to that? Mr. Robertson, then followed by Mr. Peebles.
I think Joan's suggestion about revaluing just the properties that have been altered is maybe one that could be worthy of further consideration, because I think those records would be easily identified from planning permission and building warrants, and thus it would take a large proportion of the cases where there would be a significant change, i.e. one, two, even three bands, and that was sort of felt from when they did it in Wales in 2006-07. And that's just maybe worthy of consideration from my...
And before I take in Mr. Peebles, Joan, you were name-check there. Do you want to add anything before I go to Mr. Peebles?
I was a bit surprised when Les comes in with something to do with valuation, but he shocks me all the time. The revaluation, we could... Don't get me wrong, we do have all the information from Register of Scotland, so we have married up sale prices to houses, so we have that information already. We do have all the building warrants and planning permissions, but what we don't do, we don't go inside the houses, because we don't have a statutory duty to actually survey those properties to alter the bands. We can only look at them once a house is sold. So yes, we've got all that information. Yes, we could do it. And I do think if we got our records by implementing the alterations first, as one of my suggestions, would help us to get our records correct at that point in time and get the reaction out of people through the appeals system, is this correct? And then move forward to a full revaluation.
In a second, Mr. Gibson, Mr. Peebles first.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. And I think that maybe just building on a point that David was making, that which is absolutely right, is that what we're actually trying to do is to identify the tax base. And I think that it's very, very easy, and I've seen this in discussion, to actually get bogged down in the complexities of valuation and revaluation. Not that they're actually unimportant, but we're trying to ascertain as easily and as cost-effective as we can what the tax base is to enable us to levy a local tax. And that's why we're actually undertaking that, and no more than that. Mr. Gibson's point about would volatility be smoothed out? The answer, I think, is absolutely. You can see where we are with around about 25 years of no movement whatsoever. We'd be looking at huge volatility if we were to actually move to instantly revalued properties. But that also brings me to, I think, a report which a previous version of this committee actually issued in 2002, one of the... as I said earlier, many reviews of council tax, and it set out in the 2002 report very clearly the legislative position in relation to revaluation. And it referred to the fact that there's actually two options open to Scottish ministers, one which is the power to change the ratio between bands, which we're looking at the moment, and secondly, the power to actually substitute other valuation bands. And the committee's report actually made the point quite clearly that if you actually introduce or indeed substitute valuation bands, and that would automatically trigger a full revaluation, and that's set out quite clearly in the 2002 report. So the modification to the proposals that we're actually looking at today is the first of those, which means that there doesn't have to automatically be a full revaluation.
Yeah, thank you. Kenneth Gibson.
Yes, thanks
very much, Convener. It's just that Les Robertson and Joan Hewton both seem to suggest that perhaps additional council tax should be levied on house improvements. I mean, I thought the whole point that wasn't brought in when the system was brought in was so as not to disincentivise people from actually improving their property. And, you know, I don't think it's very helpful if you're saying to people, if you improve your house, you know, you're going to have to pay an extra few hundred quid a year in council tax for having done that. I mean, surely that would have a negative effect in terms of improving the quality of our housing per se.
Yes, of course. I do actually answer that within the submission I put in.
No, but for the public record.
Yeah, for public record. We are actually looking at when the legislation was brought in, and I totally agree, we were wanting to encourage people to improve their houses. Under the old domestic rating system, you put central heating into your house, we increased your rateable value. So it was a good decision. We fully supported this decision. But it was brought in the basis that it was fully expected to have continual revaluations. Now, five-yearly has always been the norm since 1956. I can totally accept what David said, you know, maybe housing could be every 10 years, but it was expected to be regular revaluations. It wasn't meant to put you in the wrong band for 23 years.
I know Mr. Thompson wanted to come in, but Les Robertson, you were name-checked as well. Do you want to add anything to that before to Mr. Thompson?
As not being a valuer, I just think it comes down to fairness. If you're paying local taxes based on a value of a property, and your value of your property goes up, you in proportion should be make a greater contribution.
Move my house, but if I did, I would be pretty miffed if I had to pay additional taxation as a result of doing it.
The political dangers, both sides of the fence and revaluing, it's not a cost-free option either way. Mr. Thompson, did you want to...
Perhaps just pick up on that last point. My house has been extended, and I would fully expect my property tax to be adjusted accordingly. However, I would reiterate Joan's point, and just merely illustrate it by... simple example of a small button ben in rural Argyllshire in 1991 might have had next to no value, but a massively extended button ben in rural Argyllshire in 2016 with a swimming pool and with solar. You mean there? You can take this to the ridiculous. There are the example illustrates the absurdity of the current situation in that there are not insignificant numbers of houses which have substantially changed in their nature, and it seems only reasonable in those circumstances that some redress is given. Now, the Assessors Association have always understood the incentive element to not taxing improvements. So we have suggested that that there could be a five-year delay. It could be until the next revaluation. It could be even the start of the next financial year to allow people to plan. There are myriad ways of implementing a system whereby someone might move to the correct band in due course without it being deemed to be an immediate punishment or penalty for property improvement.
At some point, we're going to have to move away from revaluation onto another area. But Mr. Peebles, you wanted to add something?
Yeah, I think that the type of exchange we've heard is not untypical when we actually talk about council tax. And I'm sure all of us have been involved in that at some point or other. I think it's maybe just important to remind ourselves, unless you've already done so, and if you have, I apologise, that the council tax itself is not a perfect system, so we can't have a perfect discussion about it. It was, history tells us, it was a rapid solution to what was then a political issue. It was a tax that was fairly hastily designed at a point in time. Okay, it's worked for more than 20 years, but it was a compromise between a property-based system and the maintenance of a personal-based taxation system. And I think that that's been compounded over the years by the type of issue we've just heard about, as well as revaluation as well.
Okay, now I'm going to bring in next Andy, give me a wee second. Now, the statute before us doesn't refer to revaluation, but obviously, for many people, that's the elephant in the room in relation to taking the local taxation base forward in the fairest possible way. That's not been considered by the Scottish Government, but despite that, do you think there's a case for the Scottish Government to work with its various partners to see what a revaluation system would look like, start looking at potential structures and how to do that, and then it becomes a political decision when to implement that? And most importantly, I suppose, when we said to the last witness panel as well, whatever that new structure looks like should be designed in such a way that in 5 years or 10 years' time, we're not having the exact same argument. So you future-proof it so that for as long as there is council tax, for the next 10, 20 or 30 years, the structured statutory system of revaluation should just be in place and we move on. Because we're not scrutinising revaluation here for the sake of the order or the statutory instrument, but we can still draw things to the attention of the government. So what would you like us to draw to the attention of the government in relation to revaluation, I suppose, including that potential suggestion?
I think the kind of key thing we would all probably ask you to do is to go and look at the last consultation report that came out. It gave very clear guidelines, and that was a cross-party committee that was on that group. And so they've managed through very difficult waters, as in this committee here today, to actually steer a course through it, but come up with a reasoned report at the end of the day and the reasoned proposals of what should actually take place. And I think the other thing is, you know, your revaluations, it has to be in statute, whether you put it in that it's every 5 years, 7 years, 10 years. But you, if you have it there, you can delay it, as you did with the commercial revaluation. But if you don't have something in, no government will ever actually take that fated step of bringing in a revaluation, because one, by the time you actually decide you're going to do it and it comes into place, you could have moved out of government or whatever it might well be, but it can cause a lot of angst, and that's why you need good cross-party support to go forward.
Okay, any additional comments in relation to that, Mr. Thompson?
Reiterate that in respect of a comment Joan made earlier, that certainly as administrators it would be helpful for us to see this as a step in a scheduled path to something new. I think it would be an opportunity missed if there wasn't a greater reaction to the Commission's report, and it may even be more publicly acceptable to see steps towards what might be perceived by the public or otherwise as a more progressive and fair tax. So a clear timetable for the way forward to a more robust system would be very welcomed.
Okay, anyone else want to add to that, Mr. Peebles?
I would agree with that suggestion and the comments just made by David and Joan. And it might be, I mean, I think there's other examples from other countries of not too dissimilar size on some of the techniques which David was outlining earlier, which might be worth looking at by the Scottish Government.
Okay, that was, of course, Mr. Mulhush, Mr. Peogues now.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Based on the evidence that was received by the Commission on Local Tax Reform, there were many professional groups and bodies and indeed individuals who gave evidence almost to an individual and to a body. They were quite clear that there was a theoretical argument for revaluation, and I think it's unarguable, and I think that everybody on this panel of witnesses today would actually agree with that. Whilst there were some debate on the technicalities and the technology that would be required, the ability to do so was not in doubt. It was clear that we could actually do that. The barriers, however, to revaluation were quite clearly political. It was the simple element that there'd be a significant tax rise for individuals who had not seen a tax rise for a considerable period. And clearly that's not necessarily attractive to any political party, notwithstanding the cross-party consensus that referred to earlier. Now, the one technical point I would maybe want to make, convener, as well, is maybe just to refer to the report that I mentioned previously, which specified that in the committee's 2002 report that Scottish ministers currently have relevant powers to trigger a revaluation using secondary, not primary legislation, secondary legislation, by making an order under section 74(3)(b) of the Local Government Finance Act 1992, for the record. Sorry to be technical, but perhaps important to get across.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Robertson?
And just to be just as technical, if you were to have a revaluation under section 80 of the same Act, you could bring in a transitional relief scheme. So you could actually smooth out any anomalies, as they did in Wales. And it was a 2 or 3 year scheme, depending on how many bands you went up.
Can I just check, is it perhaps understandable we're not looking at the revaluation at the moment, given the fact that an additional £100 million per year is going to be raised from council tax on the higher bands, and the council tax freeze is ending, and it's looking most local authorities will put in a 3% increase on top of that as well. To move to revaluation now, at the same time, would that just maybe be a bit just too much all at the one time? It's not a reason not to do it, but is it perhaps reasonable in reflection to just hold back slightly in relation to that? Perhaps that's a politician talking rather than a professional who just who just have to make it happen.
Well, let me answer that would be a reasonable step if there was a road mapped into the future. If we knew that there was a revaluation coming, we would be more prepared, and it could happen more quickly. It would take less additional resource. So yes, it's not unreasonable for governments to take steps as a progression towards something that's probably more palatable all round.
This is the roadmap you want to see,
yeah,
when it's
and,
coming.
And
yeah.
Going back to the evidence that was given this morning, there was some concern over the confusion of adding the 3% addition as well as the proportion changes. So if you were to add a revaluation on top of that, then there would certainly be lack of clarity. I should perhaps just add that most international property federations, experts or otherwise, would say that a revaluation should always be considered in terms of neutrality of finance, that most revaluations redistribute, that don't increase or decrease the tax take.
Been very patient. Any other comments before we go to Mr. Whiteman for his question? No? Okay, Mr. Whiteman.
Thank you, convener. Yes, as was become clear, this order and its accompanying order are going to introduce for the first time changes that we haven't seen since 1993, when council tax was introduced. The fact that the multiplier is being increased for 2017-18, the fact that new council tax reduction eligibility criteria are being introduced, and the fact that the council tax rate itself, councils are to be given more latitude in that, is all going to happen with a fairly short space of time between now and next April. To what extent do you think the public need to be engaged and informed and made aware of these changes? Because I'm already getting constituents writing to me saying that they've got properties in band, they're in band E, but their property is worth less than properties in band B, and everyone's just going on to Zoopla, and they can find all this stuff. And of course they're lodging appeals, and that appeal will get nowhere. So
what kind of public information and awareness do you think we need to do about this? And do you anticipate any problems or issues arising as a result of people potentially appealing their banding when they do see that they are going to be faced with higher bills?
This is one of our concerns. The minute the band, although there has been the newspaper, the media reports on the fact that this is actually happening, public don't actually realise it until their bill hits the floor. And that's when we will expect to get a lot of appeals in. It was the same with Martin Lewis when he had his tranche of media attacks on the council tax system, and we literally had tens of thousands of appeals coming in through the door, all of them invalid, or 99% of them invalid. And what this does, it takes up an awful lot of time, both of public resource time and actually dealing with this, but apart from that, it's actually time in going to the Valuation Appeal Committees, which is the legal costs involved in that, and it's taking up the time of lay people that sit in those panels. So we do expect a lot of appeals. And what I would actually urge the Scottish Government to do is to try and put out good quality community communications on this, press, television, whatever you can do to actually say there is no right of appeal on this. This is purely a payment measure. There is no right of appeal. Because it will, people who see their payment going up quite considerably. And again, it comes back to the house next door that's not been extended, and it's just going to aggravate the differential between two houses that are quite different, are in the same band, and there will be a lot of discontent from the ratepayers out there.
Okay, anyone else want to add to that? Mr. McHugh?
I would agree with that entirely, and I think it will be a shock. I mean, I've been surprised. I mean, local authority officials around the country have been saying they've been surprised at how few people have been coming forwards. So I think there probably is a lack of realisation just at this moment in time about the changes to bills that are going to happen. But yes, changes of over 20% if you go right to the top of the banding system, I think are inevitably going to lead to a fair amount of public feedback, but the government has a critical communications, as do local authorities individually on this. But it is unfortunately another facet of leaving it be for quite so long.
Good. Anyone else want to add to that? Oh, okay. Andy Whiteman, do you want to come back in?
Yes, just I'm attracted to the notion of a roadmap because the Commission identified lots of flaws with the council tax such that it recommended it be ended, but to the effect that it's not being ended, that there are still those flaws. And one which you identified, we talked about earlier, was the people who do, you know, redevelopments. I mean, it's my understanding that, I mean, an order under Section 87 of the 92 Act could be brought forward to perhaps deal with that, to make those orders, to make those valuations be done a little bit more promptly, because I mean, I've had another constituent write to me saying that they've just bought a property which they looked at, it was in band B or C, I think. What they didn't realise was that it had been substantially altered. It was through the 80s and stuff. And then they were lumped with a much, much higher council tax bill, which they felt was very unfair because they didn't know that was going to happen. And the owners ended up with a windfall because they've sold a property that appears to be liable to a band B or C payment and therefore have got a higher capital payment. So is it possible to, is that one of the things we could do in the roadmap to sort that one out by order?
Most definitely. I think increasing bans for those that are altered, and yeah, I totally accept the point of view, yes, we shouldn't be hampering people from altering their houses, but some of these are substantial alterations, and I think we do need to try and start addressing this as soon as possible. Lost what I was going to come on to say there.
I have just to add to that.
Doing that as one step on the way to revaluation would possibly take some time out of the revaluation. As Joan's already alluded to, we don't have the powers necessarily to capture the change information just now. But if we were given the power to amend these bans accordingly, we would capture that information as a precursor to a revaluation. So and as part of a roadmap, dealing with extended properties may be one step along the way to a full revaluation.
Can I just say what I remembered I was going to say? Within this particular, where we only increase a band when it is subsequently sold. So there is even a slightly delay in that. The time we get the information from the Register of Scotland about the sale, it's 2 or 3 months later, we increase the band. So you're probably 4 months in the house before you're actually getting hit with this information. But we did actually lobby the people when they were doing the home report to say that should have been included in the home report notification about, and it wasn't taken on board.
Add to that? Sorry, Mr. McHugh, did you want to add? Sorry.
No.
Okay. Can I? You okay, Andy? Can I maybe ask? So, those staying in Band E to H houses will see a significant increase in their council tax bill. Many of those will be owner-occupier houses within a private commercial housing market. Could there be any implications for the market and the increase for Bands E to H? Is that a consideration?
I would have thought that the LBTT situation would have a slightly bigger influence on this. I mean, remember, it is a charge that's been frozen for a very long time now, I think around about 9 years. So at the very ultimate level, I think the difference will be £500 in the band charge that will be very, very high. So, I mean, I'm not saying it won't be a factor for potential home buyers in terms of their ongoing annual occupancy costs, but at this stage I would doubt a material change with the reforms you've got in front of you.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else in relation to that? No. Okay. No member has indicated they wish another question. Now would be your opportunity. We've got a little bit of time left.
Maybe just ask something. Mr. Simpson? If it's okay, convener. Just about the whole appeals system and whether you think that should be reformed. As you'll know, people can't appeal if after they've moved in to a property after 6 months. And so you've got a lot of people who are in the wrong bands, but they try and appeal and they're told you can't. Do you think that should be changed?
It's common assessor's policy that even where someone submits an invalid appeal, that they will check the banding. And the assessor has powers to reduce the banding if he believes an error has been made. So there are people who, despite invalid appeals, have their appeals amended, or their bands amended, where they are quite clearly wrong. The other side is a new occupier has 6 months in which to make an appeal. Some might see that as a perfectly reasonable time for someone to understand such a significant outlay and make an appeal. That all bands are publicly available, new occupiers are notified of the band, and there's a national website which people can check all the bandings. So 6 months may be deemed a reasonable time to allow someone to appeal.
Well, that's people are aware of that, Mr. Thompson, and very often they're not, and they may only realise years down the line that this becomes an issue for them.
Be able to answer better, but I understood that bills give people a brief outline of their appeal rights, is that?
Yeah, on the statutory requirements, the content and demand notice, the appeal rights to appeal against your valuation are stated. Again, it's how many people read it, and that's you've got a council tax bill, you've got the back of the bill that's full of notes. Discounts, exemptions, CTR, appeals, office opening times, all that has to go on the bill. So yeah, I totally accept your point. However, what I would add is what David said there was, maybe when you're considering this, a technical adjustment is to stop the assessor going back to 1993 when he makes a mistake. It has an impact on council tax, council's income, that if an assessor finds one property in a street, it might be a council street that's actually banded wrong, and that's identified as an error, that whole street will get rebanded. And they subsequently go back to 1993, which means that councils will have to keep records for 1993. We then have all the administration, we'll have to recalculate council tax benefit and council tax reduction, and then we'll have to try and find people who have maybe gone away that were due money back to. So it is an administrative problem that never was picked up in the regulations.
Well, I must apologise, Mr. Robertson, because I've identified in my constituency areas where households were in the wrong band. And obviously, as Mr. Thompson said, even if the 6 months is gone, once the assessor's department's aware of the inaccuracy in the banding, they will then go and look at it. The health warning with that, of course, is sometimes it increases everyone's band rather than reduces everyone's band as well. So for any of the politicians in the room, be very careful that you know your stuff before you go and do that. Mr. Gibson, did you want to come in?
Yeah, I mean, some people don't like their bands being reduced if they think if they're trying to sell a property because they think it will reduce the value of the property. But I think the issue which Graham refers to is when somebody finds out a year later everyone else in the street's paying less than them. You know, it's not that they don't acknowledge what's actually in the demand notice, it's just that they suddenly find out everyone else is paying for what they perceive to be the same house. But obviously, you know, that's because of the way the system changes in terms of people moving in and buying houses, etc., etc. But people just perceive that, you know, that that person across the road's got the exact same house as me, but they're paying a D and I'm paying an E, whatever. And that's really when you get the kind of issues that Graham's referred to, I think.
Insignificant amounts of time addressing those very issues, despite the lack of appeal rights of the person who's brought it to our attention. So there are remedies, if indeed there is an error. Where there's a difference of opinion, that is where we do have a problem.
I thought we were almost finished. Mr. Whiteman, yes?
You're encouraging some further contribution. No, just a very brief follow-up. I mean, just coming back to my question that Joan answered about appeals and the volume, etc. It's my understanding that the public have a statutory right to this appeal. There's nothing we can do to limit the number of people who are entitled to appeal. All we can do is do a job of persuasion to persuade them that it's not worth their while doing. But because it's so easy to do for them, not for you to deal with, it may not be that effective. But that's correct, and they have a statutory right. So
They have a right, what we call it, in council tax language, you submit a proposal. Anybody can submit a proposal, and then we just deem whether it's validly made or invalidly made. If it's invalidly made, it slides in to go to the appeal committee if we can't convince the person. But I think where we come from, we can't turn around and say that you can't go to a committee. That's because everybody has a right to a fair appeal system. So all we can really do is say it's invalidly made because it's out with the time or it's it doesn't meet the particular regulations. But if it meets all the regulations, then everybody, they will have their appeal heard by the Valuation Appeal Committee. But if it's an invalid appeal, it's a long drawn out process, and they will go before a committee and expect to have their voice heard. And really, many of the committees will just close them down very quickly because the committee cannot do anything with it either. You know, if it's an invalid appeal, it just has to close off.
Okay, I think we're almost there now. We've got a few minutes left if any of the witnesses wants to put anything on the public record before we close this particular evidence session. We've got a brief amount of time to let you do that, if there's anything. Mr. Robertson?
The one thing that I think it was alluded to earlier was there's been no mention, and we still haven't had any detail of what the proposal for the Scottish Government and Scottish Water are going to do with water charges. Obviously, that will have a wee bill, one bill. There is still unclear whether we're going to increase the water charges per the ratio, and I think I raised that in my submission, that needs clarified very shortly.
That's helpful, thanks for putting that on the public record. Any other, don't feel the need to, but now's your opportunity if there's something you want to say. Okay, and there's not, can I thank all of you for your time this morning, now this afternoon, of course, in helping the committee consider the statute instrument placed before us by the Scottish Government. We've got ongoing evidence sessions in relation to this in the weeks ahead, but for the moment, thank you everyone for coming along, and we now move into private session. Thank you.